It's the calm before the WWDC storm, so let's talk about what's going on in the world of Swift for the month of May. As always, links to everything you see in this video will be in the GitHub repo. Link to that repo is in the description. Let's get going. Today's video is sponsored by Squarespace. To kick things off, Apple gave us a little sneak peek of iOS 18 by announcing some really cool accessibility features like eye tracking, music haptics, and vocal shortcuts. So if I play this video, you can see the eye tracking on the iPad, similar to if you've used visionOS. I imagine it feels a little similar to that, but yeah, a great feature on the iPad. That's gonna be so cool. And then there is, what's the next one, I believe? Oh yeah, music haptics makes a song more accessible. So the haptic engine, or taptic engine, I always get that confused, but you can see it's playing like certain custom vibrations and haptics to go along with the music, so you can feel the music if you're deaf or hard of hearing. Another one is custom utterances. I already had that highlighted. Assign custom utterances for voice, right? Because if you have cerebral palsy or ALS or have a stroke, it can affect your voice and speaking may be difficult. So you can program vocal shortcuts with custom utterances that you can speak so that it can navigate your phone accordingly. That's really cool. And then the last one I'm gonna point out is vehicle motion cues can help reduce motion sickness, right? So if you're in a car, take a left turn, let me play it. You can see these dots are letting you know which way you're turning. That way, as you're reading and you're feeling the movement of the car, you don't get that motion sickness. I don't suffer from motion sickness, so I can't really relate to this, but I assume this is gonna be very valuable for those that do suffer. Next up, for those of you out there that are just getting into this world of Swift and iOS development, Apple has released something called Pathways, and it's your first step toward developing for Apple platforms. In its various pathways, essentially what they've done is they've aggregated, you know, their own tutorials, their own WWDC sessions, all this stuff, they've aggregated it into certain pathways. For example, let's take a look at the SwiftUI path. Here's the SwiftUI pathway, start your path, what you'll learn, but it starts you off with the Meet SwiftUI WWDC session, and then you go into custom tutorials that they have, taking a structured approach to design, which again are tutorials. They show you the HIG, plan for navigation, the Swift cookbook for navigation, WWDC video. So it walks you through building dive into data, some intro to Swift data. It's all the stuff that already exists out there. Apple has just curated it into multiple different pathways. For example, here's the one on visionOS. Start down your path, cool. Learn the building blocks for spatial computing. Again, just curated pathways from Apple, but I think that's really cool. Despite all the reports, visionOS isn't dead. It's not going anywhere. And I believe we're gonna get visionOS 2 at WWDC. Who knows, maybe I'll be eating my words in a few weeks, but I doubt it because Apple just released more sample code for visionOS apps. And this one is specific towards collision detection. So if you have collision detection in your visionOS app, Apple now has some sample code for you, as you can see with these balloons colliding into each other. They released another similar one dealing with particles. We'll play this video down here too. So you can see the particles going. And on the left here, you see you can adjust the speed, the birth rate, all different things with various different emitters to play around with that and see the source code. I'm a believer in visionOS. I fully admit it is not there yet. It's not comfortable after a while. I believe they're gonna make it thinner, lighter. It's going to get there in a few years. I'm a believer because the experience of like the immersive videos and all the windows around you, like it's an awesome experience watching videos on your own personal movie theater. Again, I think visionOS is here to stay. Can't wait for visionOS 2.0 at WWDC. And if you're like me and you're excited to build for it, definitely check out this source code. Moving on, we have an older article from Antoine Vanderlee, but it resurfaced on Twitter and I liked it, so I wanted to share it. But it is from 2021. It's about how to make the right career moves. And here Antoine tells a story about how he got started in iOS development with some learnings and lessons along the way. So I'm gonna skim through this. I highly recommend checking it out yourself. Picking your first Swift job. Here's the one I want to highlight. Make sure you are not alone. Learning from a more experienced developer is a must to grow fast when you're just getting started. And I say this all the time, but I want to repeat it, is especially when you're getting that first job, optimize for this, optimize for the team. Where are you going to learn the most? Where are you going to build the better network over money? And I know money's a touchy subject. Of course, everyone has their own personal needs, but if you're lucky enough to get multiple offers, take the offer that has the better team, the better network, over the higher pay. Of course, make sure you can pay your bills and take care of your family, all that stuff. I'm not saying that, but oftentimes a lot of people will choose 10K extra, 20K extra for a lesser team. Whereas if they would have just taken a little bit of a pay cut, the overall trajectory of their career would have been way better. It's just such a short-term decision to take that extra pay on a worse team. because my experience echoes this. The first year and a half of my career, I was working with another junior developer. It was like the blind leading the blind. My learning didn't really take off until I was about a year and a half to 2 years into my career, similar to Antoine. That's gonna be the next topic about find the right environment to grow, because it sounds like we both had as our second job a digital agency where they go out and find app projects to build. And oftentimes you're on a project for 2-3 months and then you move to the next project, move to the next project. And a lot of times you're building the project from scratch. And that is a key skill set to know as well. But I think the best thing I learned on my second stop at a development agency was one, bouncing around from project to project in various different types of apps. But two, this was the first time I had a senior developer just critiquing my code, right? I thought I was good at code naively. Oh boy, my PRs got destroyed. And at first it was like a little, eh. But man, I learned so much. And like I said, I feel like that's when I finally started to become like a real developer. So it is vitally important that your first job has a senior developer to learn from. The compounding effect that has on your overall career is, I can't even describe it. But anyway, check out Antoine's article about making career moves in Swift. Very good. I wanted to highlight those two topics because they resonated with me. And I know a lot of you are struggling out there to get that first job. And I hope you avoid some of the mistakes that sounds like Antoine made and I made. If you're building a macOS app, you're gonna need a settings screen. And there's a great article here from Paul Pauline about how to get a Ventura-style macOS settings screen that you see here. Because intuitively, if you're just using HStacks and VStacks like you normally do, you're gonna end up with something like this. This is his first version of the settings screen, and it doesn't look that good. Well, this article shows you how to go from that to this, where it looks native, feels at home on the macOS platform. So if you're building a macOS app and your settings screen hasn't adopted that look and feel, here you go. Last episode, we talked about how maybe MVVM isn't the best architecture for SwiftUI, and maybe the vanilla SwiftUI thing could work for your project. Of course, the whole architecture disclaimer is like, there's no one right answer for everyone, right? Find the best solution for you. But the architecture topic, as expected, generated a ton of comments, a ton of discussion, which were fun, I guess. Fun, yeah. Anyway, so let's talk about it again. The composable architecture, my 3-year experience. Now, I am presenting this with no opinion of my own because I've never really used the composable architecture. I know it's gaining popularity. I dabbled with it, you know, just to test it out, but I have no real experience. So presenting without my own opinion, because I don't know. But this is the experience of using composable architecture for 3 years. And again, another disclaimer, this is one person's experience. Doesn't mean TCA is bad or don't use TCA. But I'm using this article because there's a couple points that I want to highlight and talk about when it comes to the decision of what architecture to build, or not even just what architecture, like anything you're implementing in your app. But Rod Schmidt here talks about his experience, you know, his background working on a very large team, like a bunch of people working on one app. There was separate teams all working on the same app. So that's the context we're in here. We're not talking about one or two people working on an app. But the first thing he points out is TCA has a steep learning curve. And this is what I wanted to talk about, because even if in theory TCA, and I'm using TCA as a placeholder, I have no experience with them, but I think it is well known that there is a steep learning curve. So anytime you're introducing something into your app where it takes a while for your developers to learn, you're putting that cognitive load on them, make sure it's worth it, right? I'm not saying don't do that. I'm not saying it's never worth it. I am advising against going through all this because in theory, it'll make us more productive, we'll be able to develop quicker, but that's in theory, right? If in practice, it's really a struggle for your developers to learn, and of course it depends on your developers, right? If your team has nothing but 10-year plus veterans, well, of course, probably not an issue. But if your team has high turnover, you're bringing on a lot of junior developers, well, take that into account. You probably don't want to introduce something like this. Because again, even if in theory, once everyone learns it, it's going to be great, if they struggle to learn it, they hate working on it because it's frustrating because, like Rod says here, you can't just use SwiftUI like you learn from Apple. You can't just use XC tests. You got to like learn so much stuff. Again, just in this TCA example, just make sure all that cognitive load, all that burden on your developers is worth it. That's all I'm going to say, because I'm sure there are plenty of circumstances where the benefits are worth it, right? They're mind-blowing benefits. Well, hell yeah, do it. Just make sure that's the case. Next, I want to introduce you to a blog I recently discovered. Well, I didn't discover it. It surfaced through the various newsletters or Twitter or whatever, but Fat Bob Man's blog. And the reason I like some of the articles they do is because it's a deep dive into a seemingly simple topic. For example, what does spacing equals nil mean in SwiftUI? And I'm gonna scroll through quickly because this is a very long article, but essentially, you know, SwiftUI objects have this hidden property, right? Spacing, the hidden property of SwiftUI views. And on the surface, this default spacing may seem simple. You may think you know it, but this blog just does an insane deep dive. And this is what I think you need to do if you want to take that next step. Because another example, right, another article here is in-depth exploration of the overlay and background modifiers. You may be like, yeah, I use overlay all the time. I know background, that's pretty simple, basic stuff. Again, another huge deep dive, right? Overlay, a special case of ZStack? Like, is overlay just a ZStack? What's the difference? Like I was saying, if you want to take the leap from like, yeah, I know SwiftUI, I can build a decent app, to I am a SwiftUI wizard, these are the kind of deep dives you need to do. And I've really enjoyed going down these rabbit holes on topics that I thought I knew. And I was like, yeah, of course, that's really simple. And it's like, oh, no, I didn't know that. So I'm a fan of this Fat Bob Man's blog. Definitely check it out. Moving on, we have a video from Stuart Lynch here, mining for iOS Nuggets. Stuart was supposed to give a talk at Deep Dish Swift that I was at. Unfortunately, he got COVID, couldn't make it, but he posted his talk onto YouTube, which is cool because now I get to share it with all of you. But essentially, it's running through just a bunch of little Swift and SwiftUI nuggets that he's learned over the years. You know, things like using the new bindable property wrapper, frame alignments, how you shouldn't use, well, I shouldn't say shouldn't, but how another way to do it is not using spacer when you're trying to align things, use max width infinity and trailing alignment. View that fits. I'm going to just kind of skim through a couple of these. Identifiable enums, enum views, dynamic colors, just a whole bunch of little nuggets that I think you will definitely learn something from and be able to apply them to your code base. Hopefully you've heard that hard coding API keys into your app is not a good idea. And if you haven't heard that, well, I'm about to show you why. Because I myself had always heard that, always knew that, but I never really knew like the solution to the problem. But Todd Hamilton here on Twitter has videos showing just how easy it is to get the API key if you hard code it, or even if you try to obfuscate it into, you know, Xcode Cloud or config files. And this is especially important if you're using any kind of AI, because you get charged, you know, on a per usage basis. So if someone steals your API key, jacks up a bunch of usage, well, now you got this huge bill. So it's best practice, no matter what API key you're using, to secure it, but especially important if you're building with AI. So like I said, I like these videos he did because he just shows in like a minute how easy it is to pull an API key, you know, from an app that you have, or do a man in the middle attack right here, which is when you use something like Charles or proxy. I'm not a web dev, I don't really use those too much, but you can see the traffic going back and forth. So even if you are, you know, putting your keys in CloudKit or config files or plist, and again, in 1 minute, he shows just how easy it is to pull this information from the network traffic. So long story short, secure your API keys. I don't necessarily have the answer. It is a very hard problem to solve. I've Googled it a lot. Now, this is not an advertisement for him. Ultimately, Todd is building something to solve this problem. That's what this whole Twitter thread was, showing you the problem and then here's my solution. But I wanted to share this because it really illustrated, again, how easy it is to get an API key if you're hard coding on the client, or even if you're trying to obfuscate it into CloudKit or config files, it's still easy. So sorry, I don't have an answer for you on how to fix that, but I wanted to highlight that, like, hey, this is an important problem. Lastly, I had the pleasure of meeting Jordi at Deep Dish Swift, and his talk there was probably my favorite talk, where he built an app in 30 minutes, shipped it to Gumroad, and was already taking payments, because the idea was to learn things or to just tinker, start building insanely small projects. And this is kind of the same theme that I'm preaching with my portfolio projects, where I say, hey, take a few days on a project, build one thing in HealthKit, that's what my latest course is all about, and then move on to something like MapKit or ARKit, build a bunch of small projects. Jordi takes that to the extreme and says, Sean, a few days? Come on, get out of here. Let's do it in a few hours. Hell, let's do it in an hour. And that's what he's talking about through this talk. It's about 40 minutes long, but it's so good. And he talks about a bunch of different projects you can build in a relatively short amount of time. And then of course, that's just version 1.0. You can always build on it and improve it. But the idea of taking a few hours, building something insanely small, shipping it. Not only is that a great way to learn, but hell, you never know what can take off and actually turn into a business. Jordi makes pretty good money from his apps doing this philosophy. So I wanted to share that. That was very inspiring. And if you're here learning all the latest news in Swift, you're probably trying to build amazing apps. And it's a great idea to have a website to showcase those apps. And that brings me to today's sponsor, Squarespace. Squarespace is an all-in-one platform to help you get that iOS developer portfolio up and running very quickly. Now I know, we're developers, we can build the website ourselves, but we're also iOS developers, and I would argue there's an opportunity cost of your time. Now, do you want to spend your time learning about web development, responsive design, all the different browsers, or do you want to spend your time building apps? So that's why I always recommend letting Squarespace take that off your plate to build your iOS developer portfolio. They have all kinds of beautiful themes and templates to get you started, and you can use their next generation website editor with the Fluid Engine to just really unlock all the creativity in the world. You can even use Squarespace Blueprint and Squarespace AI to help you figure out what to write on your website, because that's always the hardest part. Like, I don't even know what to say here. Throw it into Squarespace's AI and they'll help you out. They handle all the SEO and analytics for you. Again, Squarespace, handling your website just takes so much off your plate. So when you're ready to get started, go to squarespace.com. And when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/SeanAllen to get 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain.